get over what you've done for me. You got me singing like, amen. What you've done for me, that's why I gotta sing. I can't get over what you've done for me, that's why I gotta sing. Heavy mountain, heavy valley, ever since the day you found me. I can't get over what you've done for me, that's why I gotta sing. I've been hard on myself lately. Every morning I feel the weight. When it's hard to just get out of bed, tell my heart, 'cause sometimes I forget that your mercy's anew today. Your mercies are new today. Oh, I can rest on your shoulders. There is grace to start over. Your mercies are new today. Oh, your mercies are new today. Help me rise like the morning sun. Help me see that your work's not done. Oh, Lord, when I'm less than what I want to be, Lord, I need you to keep reminding me. Your mercies are new today. Your mercies are new today. Oh, I can rest on your shoulders, there is grace to start over. Your mercies are new today. Oh, I kept thinking you were angry, but you were fighting just to hold me and pick me up every time I fell. If your love is here to lift me, and your blood said you forgive me. Your mercies are new today. Your mercies are new again and again. Start over, your mercies are new today. Your mercies are new today.
Verdict was guilty, case closed, the end. No chance for me to ever leave this prison of my sin. Now I know it might sound crazy, but one day a key unlocked that cell. I heard a small voice say your debt's been paid by somebody else. And now I'm walking, walking, walking free. No more darkness, guilt has lost its grip on me. When mercy called my name, those chains fell out. Ain't nothing perfect. I still stumble every single day. I still get knocked down, but the difference now is that's not where I stay. Cause I got a savior who knows everywhere I've been, and he's telling me that I never have to go back there again. So now I'm walking, walking, walking free. No more darkness, guilt has lost its grip on me. When mercy called my name, those chains fell at my feet. And now I'm walking, walking, walking free, walking free, walking free. To the one walking wounded, and to the one with regret, look up and see your victory is just up ahead. Cause there is a savior who knows everywhere you've been, and he's telling you that you never have to go back there again. So if you know that you never
Well, good morning, church family, and welcome to worship here at and from St. Anderson Stevens Presbyterian Church. This is certainly not how I envisaged gathering for worship on January 9th, 2022, but circumstances are way beyond our control, and so it's great to be able to gather with you wherever you are in your worship spaces. It's like deja vu, I think, for Owen and myself to have half a dozen people here this morning, but I know that you are gathered wherever you are, and wherever you are, the Lord is with you and present with you. Last week, Daniel started the new year and took us into Revelation chapter 5, a centering vision for our Christian lives, for church family, for the year ahead. And if you remember, chapter 5 of Revelation reveals that the Lion of Judah is actually a lamb. And I was struck last week as Daniel was kind of explaining and showing us all of those abs of all of the Romans. If you've ever watched the Disney movie, The Lion King, there's that incredible clip where the lion, you know, Simba, that's his name, I think, was held up from the rock overlooking the plain, and all the animals are gathered. And it's pretty natural for the entire animal kingdom to bow down and worship a lion, because a lion has got authority, it's got strength, it's got power. So there's nothing strange about it. Imagine if that movie was actually called The Lamb King. And a little lamb, little, small, fluffy, white lamb was held up. It's not natural for the animal kingdom to follow a lamb, to bow down before the meekness of a lamb. So to be able to follow the lamb is actually a choice. It calls us. It's not something natural. It's something we have to choose to do. It's been playing in my head all week as I've been thinking about that. And so I went back and I read Revelation chapter 4 again, which concludes with these words.
And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to the one who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders who represent all the people of God fell before the one who is seated on the throne and worship the one who lives forever and ever. And then they cast their crowns, again, a symbol of them laying their lives and the authority of their lives, the lordship of their lives, before the one who sits on the throne. And all of them gathered around the throne begin to sing these words: "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, because you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." So many times I've thought about that image of all of the people of God gathered around the one who sits on the throne, laying their throne, their crowns before the one, but always miss what they're singing as they do it. All of creation, all of God's people are gathered around the Lord who sits on the throne. Why? Because everything begins from there, that place. Our lives begin when we acknowledge that all of creation, our lives, find its source, its life, its being in the one who sits on the throne at the center of the universe. That's why we gather for worship. This might not be how we want to do it, but that's why we gather every single Sunday morning, to begin another week, because the beginning of another week must begin with the focus on the one who created it all, who sustains it all, who's at the center of it all. So let's gather before the Lamb. Let's choose to gather around the Lamb and acknowledge who He is. Let's worship together. For 2 years now, I remember it's actually a joy to have Jane with us this morning. She's going to be leading us in prayer in the service. And it was Jane who, I think, almost 2 years ago, we were having a conversation, and she talked about lighting a candle in worship spaces as that symbol that we were all connected, all united, all gathered before the light of the world. So I don't know how many weeks we're going to be doing this, but I hope, I pray that you once again will have those candles before you, that we will light them together as that acknowledgement that we are worshiping together. So let's light those candles now as we worship together. Let's pray. Gracious God, what a privilege it is for us on any day, at any time, to come before you, to get off our thrones, lay our crowns, our lives, our lordship before you, because we acknowledge that you are the creator, the sustainer of all creation. Life begins with you. Life flows from you. Lord, certainly this is not how we as a church family would choose to gather on the 9th of January 2022. But we can become disheartened by it. Yet at the same time, what an opportunity we have been given over the past 2 years to use the technology to continue to meet, to continue to worship together, even if we can't see one another, even if we can't hear one another. We know that we are gathered around you. So I pray that these candles in our worship spaces will be that visible reminder that we are in your presence. You have called us to yourself, that we are united together as a church family, as brothers and sisters in Christ, to worship you, to come before you and acknowledge this week, this year, whatever lies ahead for us, whatever road, wherever it takes us, whatever valley we have to walk through, however long we have to endure this ongoing pandemic. We don't do it alone. You are Emmanuel, the God who is with us, all of us. The God who is present wherever we are, wherever we go, whomever we meet with. So Lord, meet with us today in our worship spaces. Speak the words that we need to hear. Shape us. Breathe your life into us. We pray that your Holy Spirit would move and that you would have your way with us. We commit ourselves to you for this time. Just like those elders around the throne, the center of the universe, may we right now lay our crowns before you. Because you are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And so as a church family, we join together to say together the words that you taught us, Lord Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As I was thinking about this morning and kind of preparing for the focus being on online worship again, that old hymn kept coming back to mind. I think we've sung it a few times throughout this past 2 years. And because as we gather around the throne at the center of the universe, there's one thing that keeps coming to my mind is that he who sits on that throne is faithful through it all, no matter what we have to endure. So we're going to sing together. And I would encourage you, I know, as I've said months ago, it's hard to do this when you're at home on your own, but I encourage you to not just sit in those comfy sofas and chairs now, but if you're able to stand and sing as Owen shares this hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Let's worship. Great is thy faithfulness. Well, we're going to hear a couple of scripture readings now as we change our attention now in a new sermon series for the next couple of months. And so we're going to go to Karen Wood. I think Karen should be online this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Morning, Karen. Great to see you. Oh, great to see you because you've still got your Christmas tree lights up or behind your right shoulder.
Awesome. I'm in denial. I'm not taking it down until March.
awesome. How are you doing, Karen? What? How was Christmas and the New Year for you?
Christmas was good. I mean, I'm over the snow, but there's still a lot of icy patches out there. So I'm looking forward to being able to get out and run and get rid of all that, you know, Christmas good stuff that I'm wearing on my hips.
Awesome. It's great to see you. Well, I'm going to hand over to you. You're going to read the first part of chapter 1 from Deuteronomy.
Right. I'm going to read Deuteronomy 1, verses 1 to 18. These are the words Moses spoke to all Israel in the wilderness east of the Jordan, that is, in the Arabah, opposite Suf, between Paran and Tophel, Laban, Hazeroth, and Dizahab. It takes 11 days to go from Horeb to Kadesh Barnea by the Mount Seir road. In the 40th year, on the first day of the 11th month, Moses proclaimed to the Israelites all that the Lord had commanded him concerning them. This was after he had defeated Sihon, king of the Amorites, who reigned in Heshbon, and at Edrei had defeated Og, king of Bashan, who reigned in Ashtaroth. East of the Jordan in the territory of Moab, Moses began to expound this law, saying, "The Lord our God said to us at Horeb, 'You have stayed long enough at this mountain. Break camp and advance to the hill country of the Amorites. Go to all the neighboring peoples in the Arabah, in the mountains, in the western foothills, in the Negev, and along the coast to the land of the Canaanites and to Lebanon, as far as the great river, the Euphrates. See, I have given you this land. Go in and take possession of the land the Lord swore he would give to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and to their descendants after them. At that time I said to you, you are too heavy a burden for me to carry alone. The Lord your God has increased your numbers so that today you are as numerous as stars in the sky. May the Lord, the God of your ancestors, increase you 1,000 times and bless you as he has promised. But how can I bear your problems and your burdens and your disputes all by myself? Choose some wise, understanding, and respected men from each of your tribes, and I will set them over you. You answered me, what you propose to do is good. So I took the leading men of your tribes, wise and respected men, and appointed them to have authority over you as commanders of thousands, of hundreds, of fifties, and of tens, and as tribal officials. And I charged your judges at that time, hear the disputes between your people and judge fairly, whether the case is between two Israelites or between an Israelite and a foreigner residing among you. Do not show partiality in judging. Hear both small and great alike. Do not be afraid of anyone, for judgment belongs to God. Bring me any case too hard for you, and I will hear it. And at that time, I told you everything you were to do."
God told Moses, "Send men to scout out the land of Canaan. I am giving this land to the Israelites." Moses sent out one leader from each family tribe. He told the men what to do. "Go see what the land is like and whether the people who live there are strong or weak, few or many." Moses had a lot of questions. Is the land good or bad? Are the cities they live in camps or forts? Is the land good for farming? Are there any trees? Moses said, "Be courageous." So the men went and scouted out the land. They traveled around the land for 40 days. They cut down a cluster of grapes in the valley and carried it on a pole. Then they went back to Moses, Aaron, and the Israelite community to tell them what they saw. The land is good. It is flowing with milk and honey, they said. But the people living in the land are strong, and the cities they live in are large and well protected. Then Caleb, one of the spies, said, "We must go up and take possession of the land. We can certainly conquer it with God's help." But the other men disagreed. "The people are stronger than we are. We look like grasshoppers compared to them." The Israelites were afraid and they cried all night. They thought Moses and Aaron had brought them to Canaan to die. The Israelites said, "Let's appoint a new leader and go back to Egypt." Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before the Israelites. Joshua and Caleb, who had both scouted out the land, tore their clothes and said to the Israelites, "The land is extremely good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will give it to us. Don't be afraid of the people living in the land. God is with us." The Lord spoke to Moses, "How long will these people despise me? How long will they not trust me?" God threatened to destroy all the people, but Moses said, "Please forgive the wrongdoing of the people. I know you are great, faithful, and loving." God replied, "Since you have asked, I will forgive them. But none of them who despise me will live to see the promised land of Canaan." Since Caleb and Joshua had followed God completely, God would let them enter the promised land. God said that the Israelites who did not trust God would face consequences for their sin. They would wander in the wilderness 40 years, and they would not enter the promised land. All of the spies who went to scout out the land died, except for Joshua and Caleb. Caleb and Joshua trusted God. God planned for Joshua to lead the next generation of Israelites into the promised land. Joshua was not perfect, but his faithfulness reminds us of Jesus, who is perfect. Jesus obeyed the Father and trusted his plan to save people from their sins.
So our second reading this morning is from Deuteronomy chapter 3, and for that we're actually going to go and hear from Leslie this morning. Morning, Leslie.
Good morning.
Hi, great to see you.
Nice to see you guys too.
Good morning. Yeah, morning. And how was your Christmas, New Year?
Oh, it was good. Yeah, nice and quiet, but good. Yeah.
So we heard that your mum has had a bit of a trial with her apartment. She's moved back. She's moved into Summerhiller now. How's she doing?
She's actually doing very well. She finishes her isolation today, so she can get out and about in the community.
Right. Just so that people don't think, oh, has Winnie had COVID? She's just isolating because she moved into Summerhill, and that's kind of part of their regulations. I think she had to isolate for 5 days before she could really see anybody there. But Winnie's apartment block, I think, got flooded earlier, right around about the new year. So things good with you, Leslie, then? We look forward to actually seeing you here at some point in the near future. We don't know when, but I'm going to hand over to you, and you're going to read chapter 3 of Deuteronomy to us.
Yes. Next we turned and went up along the road to Bashan, and Og, king of Bashan, with his whole army, marched out to meet us in battle at Edrei. The Lord said to me, "Do not be afraid of him, for I have handed him over to you with his whole army and his land. Do to him what you did to Sihon, king of the Amorites, who reigned in Heshbon. So the Lord our God also gave into our hands Og, king of Bashan, and all his army. We struck them down, leaving no survivors. At that time, we took all his cities. There was not one of the 60 cities that we did not take from them, the whole region of Argob, Og's kingdom in Bashan. All these cities were fortified with high walls and with gates and bars, and there were also a great many unwalled villages. We completely destroyed them, as we had done with Sihon, king of Heshbon, destroying every city, men, women, and children, but all the livestock and the plunder from their cities we carried off for ourselves. So at the time we took from them, from these two kings of the Amorites, the territory east of the Jordan, from the Arnon Gorge as far as Mount Hermon. Hermon is called Sirion by the Sidonians. The Amorites call it Senir. We took all the towns in the plateau and all Gilead and all Bashan as far as Salica and Edrei, towns of Og's kingdom in Bashan. Only Og, king of Bashan, was left of the remnant of the Rephaites. His bed was made of iron and was more than 13 feet long and 6 feet wide. It is still in Rabbah of the Ammonites. Of the land that we took over at that time, I gave the Reubenites and the Gadites the territory north of Aroer by the Arnon Gorge, including half the hill country of Gilead, together with its towns. The rest of Gilead, and also all of Bashan, the kingdom of Og, I gave to the half-tribe of Manasseh. The whole region of Argob in Bashan used to be known as the land of the Rephaites. Jair, a descendant of Manasseh, took the whole region of Argob as far as the border of the Geshurites and the Maacathites. It was named after him, so that to this day Bashan is called Havoth Jair. And I gave Gilead to Machir. But to the Reubenites and the Gadites, I gave the territory extending from Gilead down to the Arnon Gorge, the middle of the gorge being the border, and out to the Jabbok River, which is the border of the Ammonites. Its western border was the Jordan in Araba, from the Kinnereth to the Sea of the Araba, the Salt Sea, below the slopes of Pisgah. I commanded you at that time, the Lord your God has given you this land to take possession of it. But all of your able-bodied men, armed for battle, must cross over ahead of your brother Israelites. However, your wives, your children, and your livestock, I know you have much livestock, may stay in the towns I have given you until the Lord gives rest to your brothers as he has to you. And they too have taken over the land that the Lord your God is giving them across the Jordan. After that, each of you may go back to the possession I have given you. At that time, I commanded Joshua, you have seen with your own eyes all that the Lord your God has done to these two kings. The Lord will do the same to all the kingdoms over there where you are going. Do not be afraid of them. The Lord your God himself will fight for you. At that time, I pleaded with the Lord, O sovereign Lord, you have begun to show your servant your greatness and your strong hand. For what God is there in heaven or on earth who can do the deeds and mighty works you do? Let me go over and see the good land beyond the Jordan, that fine hill country, and Lebanon. But because of you, the Lord was angry with me and would not listen to me. That is enough, the Lord said. Do not speak to me any more about this matter. Go up to the top of Pisgah and look west and north and south and east. Look at all the land with your own eyes, since you are not going to cross this Jordan. But commission Joshua and encourage and strengthen him, for he will lead this people across and will cause them to inherit the land that you will see. So we stayed in the valley near Beth Peor.
Well, Leslie and Karen, both of you deserve a round of applause, because the amount of names that you managed to get through there with such confidence. Thank you both for reading this morning. Bless your families this morning in these very strange times. I'm going to hand over to Jean, and she's going to lead us in prayer.
Good morning, church family, both here and online as you join us this morning. Let us, as children of God, lift up our voices as we pray to our loving God. Please join me. Heavenly and loving Father, we, your children, come to your throne of grace. In Psalm 5, it is written, "In the morning, Lord, you hear my voice. In the morning, I lay my requests before you and wait expectantly. Lead me, Lord. in your righteousness, make your ways straight before me. As David expresses in this psalm, we come to you this morning and pray that we will listen and be attentive to all that you say to us in the scriptures, in the sermon preached, and in the music that speaks of your great faithfulness to us. Give us hearts that are soft and ears and minds that listen to your word with eagerness. We wait expectantly, expectant that you hear us, expectant that we can listen to you, dear Lord. Please direct us in the life that we live as individuals, but more importantly, Lord, in the life that we live as part of this, your church. Plant our feet firmly on the path that is yours for our lives. We give thanks for Christmas and New Year celebrations and the reality that is you. Before this day, you were with us. You are Emmanuel. Today, you are present. You are Emmanuel. And tomorrow, you will be with us also. Such is your love, Emmanuel. In this hope that is you, we come. We live in this your world. Help us to see and seek you. In corners of this world, we see harvests of plenty, and elsewhere, barren, dry lands. In corners of this world and in this country, we see privilege and poverty. This is your world. Help us, those with plenty, to give graciously. To give to those who are in need, whether it be in food, in comfort, or in relationships. We hear of nations and governments that lead from a posture of greed and selfishness. We pray for people who are oppressed, ill-treated, downtrodden, and for those who do not have a voice. We lift up those who live in fear and do not experience the freedoms we enjoy. Within our church family, we know that there are those experiencing challenges of illness, of loneliness, of fractured relationships, and hardships and challenges of family life in uncertain times. In silence, we lift up those that are on our hearts. For those that are not able to live at home, that are perhaps in seniors' residences or long-term care, or for those that are experiencing long-term health challenges, we lift them up and pray also for comfort and peace for those that are caring for them. For those in physical or emotional or spiritual crisis, we pray for support and understanding, and for a friend to listen and walk with them on this path. In silence, we listen. For those that return to school, the children and those returning to post-secondary education, we know that there are challenges for both the students and the teachers. In the challenges and changes experienced each day, we pray for comfort, for wisdom, and understanding in the situations that many find themselves in. In this world, Lord, often we see around us distress and anger. Help us to be peacemakers rather than pot stirrers. In darkness, help us to be filled with the light and love that is you. Let your light illuminate the darkest corners. Help us to be merciful to all, knowing that you have been merciful to us. Amen.
Thanks, Jean, and again, Karen and Leslie, for participating this morning. Well, let me take you back to December 7th, 2020. That night, I sat down to write musings for the newsletter that was going to be emailed out to all the following morning. And in those musings, I was reflecting on the announcement that had been made earlier that day by Dr. Bonnie Henry, when she basically shut down everyone for the Christmas season. And so I wrote these words to you. What can I say? Today's announcement was expected. It wasn't a surprise, yet it felt like a gut punch. A month or so ago, when we started to have a few people come and sit in the sanctuary on Sunday mornings, I got excited, prematurely so. I started to hope. I started to plan. Could we possibly be able to have some services around Christmas and perhaps even have 40 people in the sanctuary? And as long as everyone was suitably spaced and they were wearing masks, we might actually be able to sing together. I long to be able to advertise that with you, and moreover, to actually sing with you during what will be the most wonderful time of the year. I wrote that preparing for the 2020 Christmas season. Today, 21 months into this pandemic, having just gone through a second Christmas season, it feels like we haven't progressed much at all. Of course we have, though. We as a society, as a province, as a world, have come a long, long way in the past 12 months. But the Omicron variant is causing us to be ever more cautious again, to reduce gatherings for a time. It is advisable. And I was chatting with Jean before the service. I have no idea what Dr. Bonnie Henry is going to announce before the 18th of January, but I wouldn't be surprised if we will be doing this for a number of weeks. Later in those same musings that I wrote to you from December 7th, 2020, I said this: Dr. Henry keeps reminding all of us, it's not forever. It's only for a short time. Her short is longer than my short. But sometime, hopefully soon, we will get back to some resemblances of normal. We are going to have so much fellowship next Advent, I promise. Well, confession time, church family. I made that promise in December of 2020, a promise I had absolutely no control over. My promise really was more of a hope that I had. I hope that you all had and have that same hope. But 1 year on, it feels in so many ways that we have not progressed as far as we might have hoped. Here we are, January 9th, 2022. You're in your worship spaces. There's half a dozen people here in the sanctuary. It feels as we keep walking through this pandemic, it's like we're stuck in a never-ending wilderness. I think that's why over the next 8 Sundays, we're going to reflect upon a group of people stuck.
Well, they have been stuck for 40 years in a wilderness. It's a wilderness that has lasted obviously far longer than our pandemic experiences. But now they are preparing for leaving the wilderness and embarking on something new. They are getting themselves ready for what lies beyond the wilderness. Can you imagine life beyond this pandemic? When we finally get beyond the situation we're in. The book of Deuteronomy comes at the point when the Israelites are getting themselves ready for what really is the next major event in their history. They've wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, and now they are getting themselves prepared to cross the Jordan and take possession of the land that God had promised to give them. Their wilderness experiences are vastly different from any of the experiences you and I have felt over the past 2 years. But the longer this pandemic continues, the more I get the sense that many people are waning. People are exhausted. Fuel tanks, literally and metaphorically, are running on empty. These past 2 years are feeling like an unending endurance. And we're all desperate. At least I think we are. Desperate to cross our Jordan rivers into a new land of promise. A land flowing with milk and honey. To a new beginning. Perhaps more accurately, we might call it a return to life. But before crossing the Jordan, the Israelites first had to be prepared. They had to make progress across the Jordan, and in order to do that, they had to be reminded of their past. Deuteronomy is the name given to the fifth book in our Bibles, the fifth and final book in what the Hebrew Bible calls the Torah, the law of God. The name itself, Deuteronomy, really means second telling or a retelling or a repetition of what has already been given to the people who were brought out of Egypt. Those people who crossed the Red Sea under the leadership of Moses. As you know, Moses then gets called up Mount Sinai, which is actually referred to as Mount Horeb in the book of Deuteronomy. There, God gives Moses the law, the Ten Commandments, etc. And Deuteronomy is retelling that law to this new generation of people who are now preparing, 40 years on, to cross the Jordan. But Deuteronomy is not merely just a retelling of the law. It is, in fact, a reflection, or more to the point, Moses speaking his final instructions to the people, preparing them for what lies beyond, for their new beginning, their new way. It's why Deuteronomy is seen by many scholars as being the central text in all of the Old Testament. Think about that. I love how scholar and theologian Elizabeth Achtermeyer reflects on Deuteronomy, and she says this, quote, "There is no book of more importance in the Old Testament, and no Old Testament book more basic for understanding the New Testament than the book of Deuteronomy." It's not merely a repetition of something, but it's a reflection of the past in order to prepare for what lies ahead. That's why we're looking at the first three chapters of Deuteronomy today. I would encourage you all to read all three chapters of the book of Deuteronomy some point in the next few days. These three chapters act as an introduction to the whole book, but more to the point, these chapters act as a kind of pivot from the past into the future for what lies ahead. Think of it like this. Deuteronomy is the center of the story of God's people in the Old Testament. A history that is now getting the people ready and which will unfold in books that we call Joshua, Judges, 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings. What follows in those books in the life and the history of God's people rests solely on how those people and the descendants after them will respond to the word that is given to them before these people cross the Jordan. Their lives rest solely on their response to what we call the book of Deuteronomy. Think about that. What if our futures, what if our lives on the far side of this pandemic depended upon our response to what Moses says and is teaching in this book? Would we be willing to give this book a little bit more attention? Well, over the next 8 weeks, that's where we're going to start this series anyway, we're going to focus on the opening 11 chapters of Deuteronomy. We'll see how it goes. We'll see where we're at as a community of faith, what might lie ahead for us during Lent leading up to Easter. But for the next 8 weeks, we're going to just study these opening 11 chapters, see what Moses highlights as what I would call the major principles that he gives to God's people about how they should live, how they should thrive in what is we call the promised land. So as we prepare for that journey, let's commit the journey to God in prayer. Let's pray. Father God, years ago, Moses spoke these words. You inspired him to speak them. You inspired people to write these words down. I pray by your mercy and grace that these words, not only of these chapters today, but of these 11 chapters of this entire book, would come alive and into our lives, into the life and worship and witness and ministry of this church family. Holy Spirit, speak to us, prepare us, help us to reflect, help us to look back, help us to take stock of who we are and where you might be calling us to go, to be, to do. Speak to us, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, chapter 1 of Deuteronomy opens up with a lot of place names. Karen, well done for your reading of those opening verses this morning. But these places tell us a story in and of themselves. They take us back to a point in the story when Moses and the Israelites had come out of Egypt and crossed the Red Sea. So I'm going to share a couple of screens with you, Owen is going to share a couple of slides with you. And we'll just focus in on them a little bit. So this is kind of a map of, you can see kind of the top of the Red Sea, right? And if you go on to the next slide, Owen, I've highlighted Mount Sinai, which is called Mount Horeb in Deuteronomy. Now, if you were all sitting in church this morning here in the sanctuary, I'd ask you what happened on Mount Sinai. And I know that the first person who would respond would be Russell. So Russell, what happened on Mount Sinai? The Ten Commandments. Well done. I thought you were going to say something like, that's where Moses gave the people chocolate. Awesome. Well done. So, Russell, great, it is great to see you, brother. And I know that it's a joy to have you here and not have to sit on a telephone line listening. So, don't go back to sleep because I may have another question for you later. So, it was on Mount Sinai that Moses receives the Ten Commandments, the law, comes back down. Now, now watch very carefully as Owen flicks to the next slide. Right? He's now just moved on and highlighted another little place called Kadesh Barnea, right? Hopefully you can see that on the map at home when you're looking at it. It's just north of Mount Sinai, and just north of Kadesh Barnea is the promised land. That's that little strip of land that goes up through Jerusalem and everything, right? And it's from there that the people are told to go up, literally, go north, up, and take possession of the land. So if you flip on one more slide for us, Owen, in Deuteronomy 1:21, we read this, reflecting back on that time. See, the Lord your God has given you the land. So from Kadesh Barnea, we're getting told that the land north has been given to the Israelite people. And God says, go up and take possession of it as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, told you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Now, I want us to focus on that verse just for a moment or two. God tells the people, he's already given the land to them. So, Owen, if you just flip onto the next slide. Awesome. Right? He's already given it to them, despite the fact they've not stepped foot in it. It is theirs. The land is theirs. So what do they need to do? Answer two things. Thanks, Owen. Two imperatives, two commands. Go up, right? Travel north. Go up into the land, and second command, second imperative, take possession of it, right? Notice there are no conditions, there's no explanations on how they've to go up or how they've to take possession, right? In one sense, what really is happening here is the people are being told, right, you're ready, the land is yours, go, take it, don't hesitate, just go up. But the verse, reflecting back, adds something. The people are then told, if you flick to the next slide, Owen, do not be afraid, do not be discouraged. Now, with that, hesitation will come. If you had listened to this verse standing at Kadesh Barnea, at the beginning of the verse, you would be full of confidence. The land is ours. Let's go. Let's take possession of it. Let's not hesitate. Pack up. Whoom. Let's just go. Whoosh. Let's go for it. And the very next thing you get told, do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. And you'll now start to look at each other across the aisle, right? And, why would we? Why should we be afraid? Why does anyone think we need to be discouraged? What might cause us to fear going up and taking possession? It's clear with those two little phrases that obstacles are going to stand in their way. There's going to be issues. There's going to be problems. The people don't know what those issues, those problems are, but they have to remain positive because God has already given the land to them. Surely nothing's going to prevent them from that promise becoming a reality. But we know the story. And that's why I put in the little video this morning to actually remind us of that story. Because the next thing that happens is spies are sent up north to have a look. What lies ahead? We'll just flick off that just for a moment, Owen, because that kind of comes a little bit later. So the spies, they go up, they come back, as we saw, carrying grapes. In Deuteronomy, they reflect on that, verse 1, verse 25, or chapter 1, verse 25. They say, it is a good land that the Lord is giving to us. Yes, all sounds good. But the very next verse, reflecting back, says the people became unwilling to go up, and they rather rebelled against the commandment, against the word of the Lord. They rebelled against the Lord. Now, it sounds like they're little kids, right? They've been told to go to bed and turn over and go to sleep, and they haven't. You know, they're kind of reading a book beneath their bedclothes or something. Like, they're just merely doing a kind of little disobedient act against a parent. No, that's not what's going on. The Hebrew word for rebellion is much more serious. The relationship that's actually in play here is not a parent-child. But rather, think of it this way, a king and his subjects. In other words, their rebellion is an act of high treason. That's how serious the response is of the people in refusing to do what they are told to do by their God. They are putting their lives, they are putting the history, the life of the entire nation at risk because they're disobeying their God. God reassures them. Verse 29, don't be afraid, don't be terrified. Remember what I did for you in Egypt. That's what we read summarized in Deuteronomy chapter 1. I was the God who brought the people out of Egypt and saved them from Pharaoh and brought them across the Red Sea. But in spite of that history, in spite of everything they know and have experienced, verse 32, the people didn't trust their God. They rebelled against him. They disobeyed him. God, rightly, is unhappy with them, to say the least. Because he's unhappy with them, the story goes, oh, the people make a feeble act of some sort of repentance and think, oh, well, maybe we should go up. So they go up and decide to try and take the land. But God has already told them, no, you're not going up now. But they go up, they end up getting defeated. The whole thing ends up in another disaster, and the people end up wandering around in the wilderness for 40 years. This is the history of God's people summarized in Deuteronomy chapter 1. This is their past. Disobedience, a lack of trust in God, rebellion against the word of God leads the people to disaster. And so a promise that was given to the people is delayed by 40 years. Oh, and you can share that other map screen with them now, but now God has moved them up to the area we call Moab. Right? So you can see it's just up east, northeast of the Dead Sea. If you look further up on the map, you'll see the Sea of Galilee. And Owen's even got a little mouse going there. And if you see Jericho, I think Jericho's just northwest of the northern tip of the Dead Sea, right? So, and you see Mount Nebo, right, in the top right-hand corner of that little yellow circle. That's where Moses is allowed to go up and scan across so he can get to see the promised land. Across west, looking at Jericho, right? It's from there that Moses repeats the law to God's people as they're now in that region preparing to go west across the Jordan. And it's if the people are now being told, well, now it's your turn, folks. Now the choice is yours. Your future lies before you. The same promise that was given to your ancestors is still a promise. It's now there for you to take. The land has been given to this nation. The land has been given to God's people. It's up for you to go and take possession of it, no matter what obstacles you find. Will you trust? Would we trust? Moses reassures the people of two events in the recent past where God's people were told to go and do something and they followed God's word to the letter. They went and they took possession of two areas of land occupied by two kings, Sihon king of Heshbon and Og king of Bashan. In these stories, Moses reminds them, chapter 3, verse 4, at that time we took all the cities. There was not one of the 60 cities that we did not take from them. The whole region of Argob, Og's kingdom in Bashan. All these cities were fortified with high walls and with gates and bars. Years previous, spies had gone and reported that the land was full of fortified cities, high walls, impenetrable gates. It filled the people with doubt, fear, rebellion. Now Moses reminds these people, when we followed God's word, we accomplished what God told us we would do, what God has sent us to do, no matter how hard the obstacles look. So prepare. Prepare to cross the Jordan. Moses is speaking God's word to God's people. The word by which they will live. The word by which they will thrive. The word by which God's people will accomplish what God has called them to, what God is laying before them. Deuteronomy is not a repeat of something. It is giving the people what they need in order for the people to leave the wilderness behind and cross into a good and promising land. I've called this short sermon series the Gospel According to Moses. Because what we find in Deuteronomy is good news, life-giving news. It is God's word spoken to, given to God's people, saying, follow this and you will have life. You and I are definitely not camped on the east shore of the River Jordan. I know that. But in some ways, perhaps a lot of ways, I think we are like those people yearning for what lies beyond the shoreline. I'm guessing some of us are getting quite patient, waiting for the crossing to happen. We're getting impatient with everything, with everyone. How many of us have become professional critics of Dr. Bonnie Henry over the past 2 years? How many of us now reflect and think, well, we could do it better. We know better. We know more. It's all because we're eager to cross. We want to leave the wilderness behind. We want to cross the Jordan and go into a land flowing with milk and honey. The thing is, in order for us to prepare as God's people for whatever lies ahead beyond this pandemic, we should take some time and look back. In order to move forward, we have a tendency to set goals, objectives, visions for the future. In order for us to move forward in companies and organizations, we are always looking a way ahead. Target, let's go there, let's do that. At this time of the year, personally, we call these types of things New Year's resolutions. Did you set something for yourself this year? 9th of January, how well are you doing at keeping them? Why do we set them? Well, because we imagine down the road a better me. And so we make a commitment to ourselves to become fitter, healthier, happier. A few years ago, I remember speaking about resolutions, and I quoted Eugene Peterson from his wonderful little book, A Long Obedience in the Same Direction. And he makes a startling claim. Eugene says this, millions of people in our culture make decisions for Christ, but there's a dreadful attrition rate. Many claim to be born again, but the evidence for mature Christian discipleship is slim. What I hear Eugene saying is there's something's wrong. Something's wrong with God's people. Perhaps there's far too many of us in church that are like the first Israelites, think we know better, so we live our lives according to our own way, and we disregard God. We disregard God's word. Perhaps in order to move forward, the first thing we need to do is reflect. Look back. Learn from our past. How well did we do that? When did we feel closer to God? What caused us to be excited about our faith in the past? Deuteronomy begins by doing that. It reflects back, not to point the blame. Moses is not saying to this group of people, they're to blame for why you are not already in the promised land. He's simply reminding the people of what had gone wrong in the past. Learn from the past. Learn from the history. in order to not make the same mistakes again. I want to urge all of us to do that this week. I've never been a journal keeper. I'm sure some of us in the congregation are fantastic at journaling. But I'm going to encourage you this week to spend a little bit of time, because with the current situation, we're probably spending a lot more time on our own again, in our little bubbles. So we actually have, I'm sure, a little bit of time, whether it's on our own with a coffee, whether it's out having a walk, whether it's first thing in the morning, last thing at night. Do some form of journaling this week, reflection. And I've got three questions that I would encourage you. You might not be able to do all three this week, but perhaps you could do one of them, both, two of them, maybe all three of them. Question one, when were you most alive in your faith? In the past, when have you felt most alive? As if your faith, your life was thriving. What was the situation, the circumstances in that? What were you doing? Reflect on that. Question two is the opposite. When have you felt most disconnected from God, most discouraged in your faith journey? Why? What were the circumstances around that? So kind of question one, question two, kind of reflecting on the two opposites. When have you felt most alive? When have you felt least alive? Question three, though, is slightly different. I'm going to encourage you to read Exodus chapter 20. Now, that's, as Russell reminded us earlier today, that's the Ten Commandments when they were first given on Mount Sinai. Exodus chapter 20. I would encourage you to read those through. I know you've done this kind of exercise in the past, but do it again this week. And read it so that you will allow yourself, you'll ask the Holy Spirit to prompt you, which of the Ten Commandments have you most struggled with in your faith journey? Now, this is going to require you not to give the right answer, but your answer. Be honest with yourself. Which of the Ten Commandments do you most struggle with? Why? What are the circumstances around that? I think for us, for you, for me, to move forward out across the Jordan, out of a wilderness into whatever the promised land might be, we need to look back. We need to take some time to reflect on the past. I would encourage you to do that this week. Let's pray together. Father God, my prayer is simple this morning, that you would help us individuals, as a church family, to reflect, to journal, to look to the past, and that your Holy Spirit would help us to remember, to reflect on those times when we have felt alive close to you, those times when we have felt least alive, disconnected, discouraged. And as hard as the question might be, what commandment of yours do we struggle with the most and why? Not for blame, but to reflect. Spirit of the living God, you are present with us right now. Jane reminded us of that in her prayer. You are Emmanuel, the God who is with us. Be with us this week in those reflections, to prepare us to cross, to leave the wilderness and step foot in the new life you
have prepared for us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, January 9th, 2022, I did not think we would be like this. But the Lord is present with us. We are together like elders round that throne. I hope we will continue to reflect on that. Wherever you go, whatever you do this week, God bless you. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the presence and power and blessing of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. God bless you all. We will meet together same way next week. I will say this, that because it's been a long time, we are going to plan to take communion together next Sunday because we will meet via Zoom again. So please prepare candles for as we've been doing throughout this pandemic, and also your own communion elements at home. And we will include the sacrament of communion at the end of the service next week. Until then, go in peace. God bless you all. Amen.
I don't call you by your darkest secret. I don't call you by your loneliness. The reasons you hide away from the light, they could never make me love you less. I don't call you by your broken family. I don't call you by what you can't change. The past, like a cloud, can chase you around, but hear my voice whisper through the rain. I know your story, I wrote every line, planned every step that you'll take. Lift up your head and believe what I say. I don't call you by your guilt or shame, I call you by name, by name. All the voices in your head are lying, they're saying this is how it's always gonna be. But they're all gonna bow at the strong, tender sound when I tell you who you are to me. By name.